All right, we've done a lot of HTML so far this term. Yet, if we think about it, there's still a lot of things on the web that are hard to explain with the HTML that we've done so far. For example, if we go to a search engine, and I'm going to pick Bing, not because I particularly like it, but for a specific reason. I go to Bing and I type in some term to search for. So HTML5. And I click that. I get a list of stuff associated with HTML5. All right. If you think about it, with what we know now, how is that possible? Do they have a web page for every possible thing that we type in? Even if they did, how would they know what we've typed in to put in and go to that page? The fact is that the way things like this work are a different kind of web page than what we've had. It's still HTML. If we were to look at the code, and we can right mouse and say view page source, we're going to see a lot of stuff, to be sure, but the bottom line is we're still going to see HTML. Here's a link tag, for example. Here's a div. Here's a UL. And so on down the line. So these are done in HTML. And yet, it's clear that something else is going on, right? Because if we go back and we get access to the same page, and we type in CSS instead, we get a different looking. Oh, we get about CSS. So obviously, something else has to be going on. We saw a minute ago that the page was in fact in HTML. So they are using HTML to display the web page, which makes sense. That's the language of the web. However, the page is different each time we look at it. And it's different each time we look at it depending on what we type in. This is an example of a dynamic page. All right. In web pages, you can talk about two different kinds of pages. You can talk about static and dynamic. Static doesn't change unless a person manually changes the HTML. So in other words, if you were to go back to your first homework assignment in this class and bring it up, again, in a browser, it's going to look exactly like it did the day that you turned it in. All right, exactly. No different at all. All right. Why is that? Well, because it's a static page. It's done with HTML. HTML is a static language. That is, that the HTML that's created doesn't change. All right. What we saw on Bing, and what we can think of many, many other examples of, are examples of dynamic web pages. And dynamic web pages, the content changes based on circumstances So another search result shows me one thing in the situation where I search for HTML. It shows me something else when I search for CSS, and so on down the line. Other examples of dynamic pages would be a page on eBay. All right, you go in and you put up an item for auction, let's say, and someone goes and bids on it. So maybe now the current bid is $10. Next page, they'll see the bid is $12. All right? And then if they make a higher bid, the next person that goes to the page is going to see their higher bid, and so on. The content of that web page changed, and it changed without someone changing the code of the page. Something else happened, some external circumstance happened. In other words, someone went and placed a bid on the item. So the next person that views it is going to see the item with the new price associated with it. News pages are dynamic, typically. In other words, there's code to do a news page. All right? Or let's use weather. That's probably a better example. There's code for a page if you go to weather.com or something like that. But the way the page looks and the content of the page depends on two things: where you ask for the weather for, and what day you've done it. So if I go and put in Los Angeles and do it today, it's going to show me today's weather for Los Angeles. Whereas if I go in and put in Cleveland, it's going to show me the weather for Cleveland. Sometimes it might not even ask me where I want the weather for. It might be smart enough to know at least approximately where I am. So the web page can create the content based on circumstances. All right. Let me show you another example when we do a Bing search. Let's search for Italian restaurants. If we know these are all restaurants in the vicinity. All right. This is in the Cleveland area. There's our look at the map. Restaurants around Elyria, Ohio. And so now, does that mean that all the best Italian restaurants in the world are in Elyria? No, it doesn't mean that. It means that the web server is smart enough to know where we are, and therefore it can make the page look different depending on who is making the request. In other words, a person in Elyria requesting for a list of Italian restaurants is going to get different information than a person in New York City or a person in Rome when they ask for Italian restaurants. All right? So the content of the page is different depending on circumstances. So, the basic thing that you have, a basic static page works like this. A basic static web page. So what you'd do is you'd get a web hosting service, all right? You'd purchase a domain, the www.whatever.com. All right, that's called a domain name. That way people can easily type in the name of your website instead of remembering a string of numbers which form what's called the IP address. And then you put images and so on. And it will do that for those files. Now, dynamic pages is a little more complicated. Because the server actually runs idea of approximately where a person's located. Not like a GPS signal where it can pinpoint to say we're at Lorain County Community College, but it can tell us that we're in the Elyria, Ohio area. Information and puts it together. Put in on the form for what they're searching for. It can a user, and it can pull for that request a custom page. All right. The analogy I always give is like the difference between ordering a sandwich at McDonald's and at Subway. All right. You go into McDonald's and you order a hamburger. What do? They turn around, there's a bin of hamburgers, they just grab a hamburger and hand it to you. The server didn't do anything to that hamburger. They just deliver it to you. Someone else made the hamburgers and put it out there, and the server just delivers it to you. So what does that mean? It means everyone gets the same hamburger, right? I mean, not literally the same hamburger, but the same kind of hamburger. At Subway, however, when you go, do they have a stack of pre-made sandwiches sitting in the back? No. All right. Well, they have a server that knows the recipe of how to make sandwiches and then asks you for some information. In other words, you go in and order, let's say, a turkey club sandwich. All right. It's not like they have a million turkey club sandwiches sitting in the back and they pull one. They'll ask you, what kind of bread would you like? You can say wheat bread, all right? So they start out with wheat bread. Do you want it toasted? Do you want vegetables on it? What kind of cheese do you want? What other stuff do you want on it? All the way down the line. And when they're done, they have made a turkey club sandwich just for you to your specific specifications, all right? Now, if you think about it, It would be ridiculous for Subway to have a stack of all the variations of the sandwiches that you could possibly order. All right, well, in aisle 5 of our warehouse are all the sandwiches with mayo. And in aisle 6 are all the sandwiches without mayo. And in aisle 7 there's all the sandwiches with mayo and mustard. And it would be just ridiculous. I mean, it doesn't even make sense. So they don't even try to do that. In web development, it's the same way. Bing does not have a search results page for HTML and CSS and Italian restaurants ready-made. What it has is it has a set of instructions that it can take and access data from a database, take information that you have provided from the form, and take other information about where you're located or whatever, and it writes an HTML page on the fly. So with server-side scripting, you're not writing HTML anymore directly. You're writing code that is going to write HTML. So you write a program whose output is HTML. All right? And we don't cover server-side scripting in this class. All right? But we do cover the creation of forms in HTML. Because forms is one of the main ways that the client tells a web server specifically what they're looking for. For example, a search page. You put in your search term in a text box. If I log in, I put in my name and password. The server-side script goes and looks and makes sure that that's a valid username and password, and then it's going to return to me a Canvas homepage specifically for me. So your Canvas homepage doesn't look like my Canvas homepage. All right? And it's not like they have an HTML file out there for every single student at LC. They have instructions of going through the database, seeing what role the person is. Are they a student? Are they a professor? Seeing what classes that they're in, looking at other things, and then creates a custom Canvas homepage for that particular user. How do they know what user to create it for? They know via what you type in when you go to log in. And it checks the database to make sure that you have both the username and password correct. Now again, the server can use other stuff. The server could use the time of day, for example. I know if you do a Google search on some things, it will tell you the hours that they're open, and they'll tell you if it's open or closed. Right? Well, it obviously uses your time of day to see, and if something opens at 10 a.m., it will tell you now it's closed. But if you went and did the same search at 10:30, it would tell you that it's open. All right. A TV network that shows its listing. If you went now and looked, it would show you what's on today in the morning. If you went later on today, it would show you what's on today in the evening. And if you logged in tomorrow, it wouldn't show you back what's on today. It would show you what's on tomorrow. All right. So all those things go into play and are used by the server to create a custom web page. Now, here's an important thing. When you leave McDonald's and you leave Subway, in both cases, you have a sandwich. All right. So if I go to Subway, it's not like they're going to hand me a recipe for a sandwich and say, well, here's your order. All right, that's not going to do you any good. They're handing you a sandwich. So, in terms of this, what gets delivered to the client is the same regardless of whether it's static or dynamic pages. So, this is the model for dynamic. But it doesn't matter. Both static and dynamic, you give the client a web page. What's a web page consist of? It consists of HTML, CSS, maybe JavaScript, maybe other stuff. All right? The only difference is that in the case of HTML, static pages, the pages are complete and simply need to be delivered to the client that asks for them. Where in the case of dynamic web pages, the server has to do some preparation first. And the server will do its preparation typically based on input that the user types in on a form, along with other stuff, like maybe the time of day, maybe the contents of a database, maybe what platform the user's on. The user's on an Android device versus a PC, if the user's on a Mac versus a Windows machine. All those things come across as part of the request and can result in customization of the page that's created. So what we're going to do today is we're going to start looking at the form side. All right? Forms are code in HTML that allows you to gather and send information over to the server for the server to process it and create you a dynamic page. So like going back in the subway example, a form, and they probably even have a form to order online or something like that, you know. A form for a sandwich would have like check boxes to say which kind of bread do you want, and you'd pick one. What kind of sandwich do you want? Toasted, yes or no. Do you want lettuce on it? Do you want olives on it? And so on down the line. What kind of cheese do you want on it? Do you want any kind of other toppings? And so on. So they could actually have a form on an online app, or they could give you a thing to fill out by hand, and you could fill it in. So the forms are done in HTML, and they're done to allow the client to give to the server the information necessary for the server to do its job. Equation. We're going to let someone else do this part. We're going to concentrate on creating a form. And we're going to start by creating our own form to do a Bing search. All right? We're going to call the server-side scripts on the Bing server, and we're going to pass data to the Bing server through a form that we create. And again, they allow you to do that. They want you to use their search engine, and this is one way that you could incorporate a search engine into your own site, is to have a form on your site that runs out and does a Bing search. So let's create a form. All right, I'm going to go in here. I'm going to put my basic stuff that I always have. All right, that's our basic shell. Let's create the form. All right, first that exists with a form tag, it's a form tag. All right, and this form has two attributes on it: action and method. All right. The action is either post or get. All right. It's one of those two things. We're going to stick with get here. What does that mean? Well, when you say the method, the method is get, it means it's going to pass the data from the form to the server using what's called the query string. What's the query string? The query string is a question mark at the end of the URL, and after the question mark is the data that the client is sending to the server. Now, we can notice something right off, right? What's that? That's what we typed into the form, right? What's it called? It's called Q, all right? Everything on the query string is done in pairs. There's a name of an attribute, and then there's a value of the attribute. Now, in this case, whoever created the Bing search decided they were going to call the thing that you're searching for Q, probably Q for query, all right? So as long as we match that, we can make our form submit to the Bing search engine, provided we set up the form correctly. Well, they're passing data on the query string, so we're going to pass data on the query string as well. So how do we do that? We say method equals get. The second attribute we have is the action. And the action is the name of the script that's going to process our request. Remember, we're not calling a static web page here. This isn't like a link where we simply click on a button and we go to another web page. We're sending data to this web page. We're sending data to the script for that data to be processed and to create a finished page. So we have to say the name of the script that we want to send that to. Because there could be a whole bunch of searches on the Bing site for image, for news, for audio, video, and so on. The action is going to be the part of the URL prior to the question mark. So http://www.bing.com/search. So that is the script that we want to call. Everything after it is the data that we're going to pass. The rules for this are the same rules that you would have if you're creating a link. This is not on my server, so I have to put in HTTP, the name of the site, and then the script. Normally, if you're working on the project, you would create both the form and the processing page. So you would be responsible for making up the processing page. What we did not talk about is what language the server-side scripts are written in. All right. We know that they can't be HTML because they're dynamic, and HTML is not dynamic. So what are they written in? Well, they can be written in PHP. That's one of the choices. They could be written in ASP.NET. They could be Java servlets. They could be done in Perl. They could be done in Python. They can be done in any number of server-side scripting languages. There's probably dozens of them. All server-side scripting languages work the same way, though. They take input from the client and create on the fly a web page that matches the specification of what was requested. Okay, so here we have a form with a method of get. That means we're passing the data on the query string. That is, we're going to see the data after the question mark. Action equals http://www.bing.com/search. That's the name of the script we're going to call. So that's all we need to do in the form tag. I can put the end form tag down here, and we're going to fill in some stuff in the middle. Now, what we put in the middle is we put all the stuff that we're going to send to the server. Now in this case, all we're really going to do is we're going to have a text box that we're going to send whatever we typed in the text box to the server. But other forms could have more stuff in it. A login form, for example, has username and password, so it has two things. If we're registering for a site, if we go to create an account on Amazon, for example, we might have our user ID, password, our first name, our last name, our address, city, state, zip, phone number, email address, and so on down the line. So think of this form tag as like being an envelope that you're going to like send a letter to the server. And you put in the form tag everything that you want to include in that letter. So it's not just necessarily just going to be one thing. It could be a bunch of stuff if you want to send a bunch of data to the server. In our case, though, we want to send just one thing, a piece of text. We're going to use what's called a text box. So, we're going to see more uses of the input tag to do things other than text boxes. But to do a text box, you say the tag is input and you give it an attribute of the type equal to text. Now the name. I say name equals Q. Why do you suppose I called the name of that Q? Because it's a query, and because when I look at their URL, that's what they call the thing you're searching for. When I typed in Italian restaurants here, notice up in the URL, Italian restaurants, and again, Q equals Italian restaurants. So everything on the query string is the name of a value, an equal sign, and then the value. Well, the value is going to come from our text box. So it's whatever I type in the text box, we're going to send to the server. The name, though, is something that whoever created the script decided on. And again, sometimes you'll be the person that creates both the form and the script that processes it, but not today. Today, Mr. Bing created the name of the variable, and the name of the variable is Q. So I'm going to match that, and I'm going to call my text box Q. So whatever I type in here is going to get passed on the query string with the name of Q. And I'm calling this script, so in other words, I'm going to be more or less recreating what they have done for a Bing query. All right. I need a submit button. All right. Type equals submit. Name equals go. Where do you suppose I got that from? Right here. Value equals submit. And that value is what's going to appear on the button. All right. Submit button. There's a couple of kinds of buttons, but this is the first button that we're looking at. And what it says is, go and send the data in the form to the server. That's what a submit button does. In other words, if the form tag is like an envelope that you put a bunch of things in that you're going to mail to the server, the submit button says, okay, go and mail that envelope. Drop that envelope in the mail, send it to the server, and get the results. So a type of submit says, data to the server. All right, let's go and try this out, make sure it works. Call this search form. We'll save it on the desktop. I'm going to keep this open. And I go on the desktop, double click my search form, and I see text box, and I see the submit button. The value is submit. Well, that's the value that's going to get passed on the query string. That's also the text that is going to appear in the button. So now I go and type something in. Click the submit button. That sends my request to the Bing server, and it fills out the form, it fills out the query string the same way they did it. That's what made it work. All right? Because if I called that, instead of calling it Q, if I called it something else, then it wouldn't work because the server's expecting that value on the query string to be called Q. All right? And it gives us essentially the same results that we have as when we did the regular Bing search. Question? Okay, the reason I didn't is Google does some things and that makes it not a suitable example for this. Let's pull it up and let's see what they do. Actually, we probably could use that. All right. What would the change to make this use Google instead? Now let's look at the URL. You're on the right track, but HL is what we typed in the query. HL is EN, which is probably our default that we want our results to be English. If we go down the line though, oddly enough, it's also Q. So we don't have to change the name of this text box to Q, or from Q. It's already Q. What do we need to change? We need to change the action, right? To tell it not to send to the Bing server, but send to the Google server. Last time I tried to do this, there were some complications with Google. That's why I used Bing, because it's simpler. Apparently, those complications no longer exist. Well, good point. We don't know yet. Right. I'm optimistic, though. Oh. I forgot I put that URL at the end. Now we open it up, we type Italian restaurant, submit. Nope. It does work. Right, whatever problems I was having must have been temporary, or they've changed something again to get rid of it, or I was having a bad day, or whatever. All right? Could be user error. It's always a possibility. All right? But again, you see, how do we change that? Well, we had to make sure we matched what Google expected. Now, again, Bing probably just copied a lot of that stuff and called it Q because that's what Google did. And even the URL looks the same. The only difference is we call it on Google server instead of on Bing server. But in a nutshell, that determines what it's going to be called on the query string. This is the script that we're going to. And we can then submit our data to any server. All right. That's expecting it. Now, if they didn't want us doing that, they could have blocked us from doing that. So they encourage you to do searches that way. All right. Now, text box is one kind of form control. And a text box is suitable for putting in like a single line of data. So you could use a text box for like a search term. That's perfect for that. You could also use it for like a first name, last name, telephone number, email address, city, state, zip. What are some other form controls besides a text box? What are some other things that you've seen on a form that aren't plain old text boxes? Okay, one of the other things is radio buttons. Now, what is a radio button? Radio button is like talk, right? You can only listen to one station at a time. If I press button, whatever I programmed station one to be. If I button, it turns on station one, it's on station two. Have one option at a time. So maybe we have a choice of are you faculty, student, or staff? All right, maybe we have that on Elsie's web page. If these are done with a radio button, I pick one, my selection of something else, it automatically unselects the first one. Could I use a text box for that? Could I just have a text box that says employee type? The answer to could I is almost always, yeah, I could. The better question is that a good idea? No, why not? Someone could misspell it and the data wouldn't be consistent. So, for example, for employee type, one person could type in professor, another person could type in teacher, another person could type instructor, someone could type in associate professor, different variations of that. If we want the data to be consistent, all right, for connecting this to a database, all right, and we needed the data to be consistent, we want to limit the number of choices to a certain set of allowable choices. We don't want someone to be able to type anything in. We just want to limit them to a handful of choices. Now, radio button are mutually exclusive choices. So I could not pick faculty and student. Or I could not pick student and staff. Is that realistic? Are there people that are both student and staff here? Yeah, I was going to say, I think we have one in this room, right? Yeah, exactly. So radio button might not be the best choice for this. What would another option be? What are called checkboxes. Exactly. Checkboxes are similar to radio in that it limits your options. In other words, we're not typing in. The difference between a checkbox and a radio box, these checkboxes work independently. So if I pick one, it doesn't unpick the other ones. So I could pick then that I'm a student who's also a staff member, and that would be allowable. So you have to decide when you're entering in, when you're creating a form. Part of your job is to decide what the most appropriate fields are, or field types rather. All right? If there's only a certain number of choices, you don't want it to be a plain old text box. A plain old text box is good where there's free form, you know. A name could be, you know, there's thousands of names. Just let the person type in their names. Millions of names. Addresses. You know, you don't want to have a list of every valid address in the world and let someone pick that, right? Just have them type it in. But something like employee type, there's only a few defined employee types, all right? And you'd want to limit to those and not have to worry about misspelling or someone using a different term than another person and so on. Mutually exclusive, you could use radio buttons, all right? Not mutually exclusive, so if someone could be more than one category, you could use a checkbox. What's another way that you could use if the choices were mutually exclusive? Besides a radio button. Use a drop-down list. So. If we wanted to say, you know, pick your main role here on campus, where you had to pick between student or staff and it was mutually exclusive, then we could use a radio button. Pretty much anything you use a radio button for, you can use a drop-down for and allow the person to select from a list. Now, interestingly enough, you can actually make a drop-down allow you to select multiple things. Then it acts like checkboxes. But that's sort of non-standard and would be likely to confuse people. So you could use, generally speaking, you could use either a radio button or a drop-down when you have a set of mutually exclusive choices. If they're not mutually exclusive, you could use checkboxes. Or you could use a radio button. With a yes or no value. So you could pick yes, I'm faculty, no, I'm not a student, no, I'm not staff, if you wanted to, if they weren't mutually exclusive. You could also use a drop down for this the same way, have yes or no values, or you could use the multiple option drop down, but again, that's confusing for people. So part of your job when you create a form is understanding the data that you're collecting and what the possibilities of it are and design the form in the right way. And then to design it in a way that's going to make sense and looks good. All right. So if I had a lot of choices, maybe I'd use a drop down. If I only had a handful of choices, maybe I'd use radio buttons. This particular case, a checkbox seems better than a series of yes-no questions. But there are other yes-no questions that you might want to have as yes-no. If I was doing a true or false quiz, you know, HTML5 is out of date, true or false. I could have a checkbox where checked it means true, and leaving it unchecked is false. But that's a little confusing. I probably instead would have a drop-down ahead, yes or no. All right, that would make it more clear. So that's part of your job, is to decide these other form controls. Now, next week, what we'll do in the first class of the week is we'll finish up the discussion of form controls, because there's a handful more, all right, and then we'll actually show you how to create and how to style a form, and how to create and style a form in an accessible manner, because there's some accessibility challenges specific to forms that we'll cover. Are there any questions? All right, we'll see you up in lab.